This video was made possible by Audible. Get your first audiobook for free at audible.com/mustard. At first glance, the NS Savannah looked like an ordinary cruise ship, with a pool for taking a dip, a dining room, and a lounge that doubled as a movie theater. But there's one thing that set this ship apart from any other. Inside this unmarked space, just a few meters from the passenger staterooms, was a nuclear reactor, something unheard of on a passenger-carrying ship before or since. And it meant the NS Savannah could do incredible things, like circle the Earth for years without stopping. In the 1960s, nuclear power was viewed as a revolutionary, near-limitless source of energy. But what was less certain was whether putting a nuclear reactor aboard a civilian ship was really a good idea. As one of the first ships powered by a nuclear reactor, NS Savannah was going to prove that nuclear power was a safe, clean, and near-limitless source of energy that could revolutionize ships. Because to make one trip around the Earth, a typical ship will burn through more than 20,000 barrels of bunker oil, all the while billowing toxic smoke into the atmosphere. The NS Savannah was designed to make that same trip without burning anything at all, because it could circle the Earth using just a few pounds of a new kind of fuel called uranium. Replacing an oil-burning engine with a small nuclear reactor promised to make ships of the future more economical, faster, and reliable. It would also eliminate the need for large fuel tanks, freeing up more room for cargo and passengers. Nuclear-powered ships could also travel for years on end without needing to refuel, and at much higher speeds, opening up new trade routes that could reshape maritime trade. But despite all the promise of nuclear power, the world had good reason to be skeptical. In the 1950s, nuclear really only meant one thing. Its enormous destructive potential and the hidden dangers of radiation were widely feared. Nuclear weapons had been around for nearly a decade, but the peaceful use of nuclear energy was still a new concept. So, in 1953, US President Eisenhower launched the Atoms for Peace program. In an effort to win over hearts and minds, research, funding, and equipment would be sent throughout the world to advance the peaceful use of nuclear energy. And the NS Savannah would be built as a floating example of what an atomic-powered future could offer. As the first of its kind, the ship would carry both passengers and cargo at the same time, demonstrating that nuclear power could be safe and viable for all kinds of uses out at sea. The NS Savannah was designed to look like the ship of the future. From the teardrop-shaped superstructure to the streamlined cargo cranes, everything about this ship was designed to stand out. But what really set it apart was the power plant. At the heart of Savannah was a 74-megawatt pressurized water reactor. Its role was to generate heat, creating steam to drive the ship's turbines. The reactor was a complex piece of machinery, but it worked on a relatively simple principle. Inside, uranium fuel elements are bombarded with neutrons in a process called nuclear fission. The neutrons split apart uranium atoms, releasing energy in the form of radiation and heat. As the uranium atoms split, they release additional neutrons, which collide with other atoms, creating a chain reaction. It's a carefully controlled process that releases an enormous amount of energy, but it also produces harmful radiation. A person standing next to an unshielded reactor would receive massive amounts of dangerous ionizing radiation. So safety was at the forefront of every aspect of Savannah's design. To keep passengers and crew safe, mere meters from the reactor, engineers built in layers of protection. The reactor was surrounded by a primary radiation shield, a thick steel containment vessel, and a 500-ton biological shield, all of which were designed to stop stray neutrons and radioactive material from escaping. Radiation exposure to passengers and crew would be kept well within safe limits. On most parts of the ship, it would be indistinguishable from natural background radiation. But engineers also had to account for the fact that ships face rough weather, get into accidents, and in the worst case, sink. So to counter severe weather, Savannah featured one of the first ship stabilization systems, using hydraulically actuated fins to counter rolling motions. The ship also featured a reinforced hull and energy-absorbing structures to protect against collision with another ship. And in the unlikely event that Savannah were to sink, the reactor was designed to automatically shut down and one-way valves would flood the containment vessel with seawater, preventing radioactive material from escaping. Engineers had thought of every possible disaster scenario, and Savannah's builders boldly claimed that their ship was one of the safest ever built. All that was left was to convince the world. Though it had taken 6 years to develop and build, Savannah surprised even its designers. The reactor produced more power than anticipated. The ship was designed to top out at 20 knots, but could easily surge along at 24. Amongst the grimy, soot-covered merchant ships of the era, Savannah was undeniably striking. In May of 1964, Savannah set sail on an ambitious world tour to demonstrate the merits of nuclear power. Over the course of a year, it made visits to U.S. cities along the eastern seaboard and to over a dozen European ports, crossing the Atlantic several times in the process. The ship traveled nearly 150,000 kilometers, using only 35 pounds of uranium. Each time Savannah pulled into a new port, huge crowds formed to greet it. In the first year alone, 1.4 million people lined up to tour the ship. Savannah's world tour had gone fantastically well, generating enormous public interest and plenty of positive press. Savannah's commercial operator was so happy with the ship's performance, they urged Congress to fund another 4 nuclear ships based on Savannah's design. And back in the United States, additional crew were being trained in anticipation of serving aboard future nuclear ships. If nuclear propulsion really was the future, momentum seemed to be building. Savannah had made nuclear propulsion look easy, as the ship cruised effortlessly from port to port. But hidden behind the sleek lines and gleaming white paint stood a harsh reality. There was nothing straightforward about operating a nuclear ship. Before Savannah could pull into a port, it needed special permission, and the request had to be made months in advance, and ports often refused over safety concerns. So, behind the scenes, Savannah's representatives would have to fly out well in advance to begin negotiating agreements, covering everything from how to respond if the ship were to cause a nuclear accident to who would be liable. Gut-level skepticism about floating nuclear reactors wasn't going to disappear overnight. And to make matters worse, Savannah's design wasn't very practical. The unusual half-passenger, half-cargo configuration meant the ship wasn't good at carrying either. The passenger accommodations took up a lot of space, while the cargo holds were too small. And with so much emphasis having been placed on an eye-catching design, the ship's sleek lines made cargo handling difficult. Savannah also needed a highly trained crew, about a third larger than on a conventional ship. For a ship built to prove that nuclear power could be commercially viable, Savannah seemed to do the opposite. Even as the ship's operator publicly boasted about Savannah's performance, their operating costs were heavily subsidized, consuming millions each year in taxpayer money. But in one very important way, Savannah could still be considered a success, because it helped inspire other countries to build their own nuclear-powered ships. In 1964, West Germany launched the NS Otto Hahn, a nuclear-powered ore-carrying freighter. It was celebrated as Germany's ship of the future, and like Savannah, the prototype ship was supposed to prove the viability of nuclear propulsion. But it didn't quite generate the same fanfare as Savannah, and would face growing opposition. Many countries denied Otto Hahn permission to enter their ports, and it was outright banned from sailing through the Suez and Panama canals. A third Japanese nuclear ship would do much worse. The NS Mutsu was supposed to pave the way for a whole fleet of high-speed nuclear freighters. Instead, the ship would only spur anti-nuclear sentiment. During an initial test run in 1974, crews detected a small radiation leak caused by faulty shielding. The incident made national headlines, but the media misreported the issue, claiming that the ship was leaking radioactive material. The public was so outraged, a flotilla of fishing boats blocked Mutsu from returning to its home port for nearly 2 months. Up against enormous public opposition, Mutsu never stood a chance, and an embarrassed Japanese government abandoned their plans for further nuclear ships. A fourth nuclear cargo ship built by the Soviet Union in the 1980s also met opposition. In the shadow of the Chernobyl disaster, public protests led to the ship being barred from entering major ports in the Soviet Far East, and harbor workers, fearing radiation exposure, refused to unload cargo from the ship. Nuclear energy never stopped being a decisive issue, but civilian nuclear ships would also have to contend with other headwinds. Although they promised to be cheaper to operate, they were more expensive to build. There was also a lack of supporting infrastructure and unanswered questions about liability if something were to go wrong. While a technical success, Savannah's design meant it could never be profitable and lasted just 5 years in commercial operation. In 1971, the reactor was defueled and made inoperable. Otto Hahn carried cargo for 9 years, but its reactor was eventually removed and replaced with a conventional diesel engine. Mutsu never carried cargo, and after having traveled just 82,000 kilometers, its reactor was also swapped for a diesel engine. Along with a handful of nuclear icebreakers, Russia still occasionally operates the only remaining nuclear cargo ship, mostly carrying military cargo in the far north of the country. Today, more than 90,000 merchant ships operate on the world's oceans. And the majority burn low-grade bunker oil, the most polluting oil available. One large cargo ship can put out as much hazardous sulfur dioxide as 50 million cars. And while the public remains focused on the potential dangers of nuclear power, shipping-related emissions have led to 400,000 premature deaths each year from lung cancer and cardiovascular disease. If just a dozen large cargo ships were powered by nuclear reactors, the reduction in global emissions would be considerable, and they would join the hundreds of nuclear-powered vessels that have been operated safely by the U.S. military over the past 50 years. Today's nuclear technology is safer and more economical than it was 60 years ago when Savannah first set sail. But the development of nuclear-powered civilian ships remains frozen in time, because the biggest obstacles still remain, especially public perception. My own perceptions changed after listening to Atomic Awakening on Audible. A fascinating dive into the history of nuclear energy, from early naive optimism to fear and skepticism. Madoff turns a complex subject into something that's easy to understand and highly entertaining. And he makes a pretty compelling argument about how a second atomic age is on its way, as fossil fuels become too expensive and the climate crisis becomes increasingly dire. Atomic Awakening is just one of many thousands of Audible titles you can enjoy with an Audible membership, covering everything from fiction to history to science and engineering. These days, it's hard to find time to sit and read through an entire book. Instead, with Audible, I can listen while commuting, exercising, or doing work around the house. With Audible, I actually look forward to mundane activities so I can learn and be entertained. As an Audible member, you get one credit every month good for any title in their premium library, including bestsellers and new releases. You also get access to the Plus catalog, which is filled with thousands of Audible originals, podcasts, and audiobooks. Start your 30-day free trial of Audible and enjoy a free book of your choice by going to audible.com/mustard or text mustard to 500-500.